Okay, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
This session I'm going to discuss. Good afternoon. In this session, I'm going to discuss about the different data structures. Okay, this is the general concept, how to implement those data structures in Python that we are going to discuss. Okay, so first, let me start with list. Let me start with list. So what is a list? First point, okay, it is basically a data structure where you can store the sequence of items. Okay, you can store sequence of items within the list. Okay, basically it is ordered in the sense first item, second item, third item, fourth item, like that. Okay, the items are arranged in order, and it is mutable in the sense it is changeable. Okay, so once you create, okay, once you create, you can update it. Okay, I'm just creating a list. I want to change the fourth item. I want to remove the eighth item. After creating the list, that is possible. That is actually called mutable. And the fifth one is, it allows duplicate members. Okay, it allows duplicate members. For example, 10 can come 5 times, 6 times. Okay, the same item can be present. Okay, even you can have a list with the same item. Okay, all the items are same. First one, how do you define a list? Okay, how do you define a list? For example, I'm just defining a list. You need to use square brackets, then Python understands that it is a list. Okay, if you are using square bracket, Python understands that it is a list. For example, I can have a list something like this. Okay, just execute. Okay, this is basically the list. If you see what is the data type of L, that is basically list. Okay, so not necessarily integer, you can have float values also. You can see you can have float values, even you can have strings. Okay, you can have complex numbers. Okay, you can notice a list is created. Okay, with a list is created with the different data types. Okay, this is heterogeneous in nature. I have an integer, I have a float, I have a string, I have a complex number. Even a list can contain another list within that. Okay, that I'll just explain. Okay, later. Then I said it is okay. Each one I'll just some examples I will validate each one of this point. I'll just prove that it allows duplicate members. Say I can have many hundreds. You see, okay, 100 is repeating, so it is not showing any error. So list, okay, it allows duplicate members. Okay, it allows duplicate members. So now, how do you access the list items? how do you access the list items? Okay. So if you want to access the list item, okay, the list name, I just want to print list name, then in square bracket, you need to give the index. Okay, here I'm just writing what is the syntax, list, and in square bracket, you need to specify the index. Okay. Very important, as I said in today's morning class, I think session two, in Python, the starting index is, the default starting index is zero. Okay, zero. So if I want to access 100, I need to give zero. Just execute, you can notice it is accessing 100. Okay, list name in bracket index, you can access the item. Okay, you can access the item. Then suppose if I want to access fourth item, okay, so fourth item is 100, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, fourth item is 100. Okay, so I can access 100. Suppose if I want to access this Vinod, this is actually 0, 1, 2, second index. You can notice I can access Vinod. Suppose I want to access third character of Vinod, that means 0, 1, 2. I want to access N. Then you add another square bracket. In that you give the index name 3. So you can access N. Okay, 3 means 0, 1, 2, 3. 3 means O you will get. Okay. You can notice the output is O. Okay. The output is O. So this is actually accessing the list items using positive indexing. Access the list items using positive indexing. Okay. So in Python, negative indexing is also allowed. Negative indexing in the sense, so positive indexing, I'm just starting from the left and I'm just moving towards right. Whereas negative indexing, I will be starting from the right and I'll go towards left. So the first negative index is minus one. So minus one indicates this 100. Okay. So access the list items using negative indexing. Okay. I don't want to print this. See, I'm just giving minus one. See, minus one is printing 100, not this 100. Maybe just for differentiating, I'm just taking another number. Okay, some numbers, different numbers. You just see now it is indexing to the last item 100. Suppose if I want 40.2, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, I have to give minus 3. Okay, you can notice it is displaying 40.2. Okay, it is displaying 40.2. Positive indexing and negative indexing. Then range of index. Okay, range of index. For example, I'm just printing in square bracket, I'm giving 1, 2, 4. Any guess? Output, any guess?
Two plus 3J, then Vinod, then 40.2, then 1000.
Okay. See, always you remember the stop index is there, right? That is exclusive. Okay, stop index is exclusive. So 4 is the stop index. Okay, so this 1000 is exclusive, so you won't get that. Okay, okay, excluding that 1000, see 2 plus 3j, we know 40.2. Okay, similarly, if I don't give anything here, any guess what is the output?
From starting to 40.2, sir.
Good. So the default starting start index is 0. So you will get everything. Suppose now
error, sir.
Okay, error is one answer. Any other answer? Any other answer? Okay, I'll execute. See, it starts from Vinod index 2 and it prints all the item. So please make a note of it. If you don't specify, if you don't specify the stop index, by default stop index is up to the end of the list. Okay, it will run up to the end. Up to the end of the list it will run. Any guess now? Any guess now? What is minus 4? What does it indicate?
From
2 plus 3, sir.
Minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4. Minus 4 is not 2 plus 3j, it's Vinod. Okay. Minus 1?
200, sir.
Okay. So minus 1 is stop index, whether it is inclusive or not.
No, sir. It is.
So what are all the things it will print?
You know, 40.2000.
Good. Okay. Now, okay, I'll go for some start index. See, now I am giving the third input argument, which is step size. Okay. Now, can you first say what are the indices now? What are the possible indices? What is the first value? Forget about what is L of that value. If I give 1 colon 5 colon 2, what is the first index?
2 plus 3j.
No, leave about the value. First you leave about the value. What are the indices? Indices, I'm asking about indices. If I give 1 colon 5 colon 2, what are the indices?
1 and 3, sir.
1
and 3.
3. 5 will not come. Okay, so L of 1 is 2 plus 3j. L of 3 is 40.2. Is it clear? Now, minus 1 minus 5. Any guess? Can you tell the indices? What is the first index? What is the first index?
Sir, minus 1, sir.
Minus 1.
Next one?
Minus 3.
Okay.
That's it.
So minus 1 indicates 200, minus 3 indicates 40.2. Let us check. Is that okay? Okay, so this is how you can access items from the list. So if you are comfortable in this positive indexing and negative indexing, the same concept in tuple, same concept in string, same concept in set, okay, same how you are accessing list, in the same manner you will be accessing set, tuple, strings, everything. Okay, okay. Oh, I said it's a data structure, sequence of items. We know sequence of items, it can be heterogeneous. We know it is ordered. Ordered means first item is this one, second item is this one, third item is this one. It is ordered. Since it is ordered, then only we can access it with the index. Okay, we know this. It allows duplicate members, that also we proved. We need to prove that it is mutable. That means after creating also you can change. Okay, say for example I created the list. Okay, this is the list I have created. I want to change the item. Okay, say for example instead of 2 plus 3j, mistakenly I have created, instead of 2 plus 3j the item should be 3 plus 4j. So it's very simple. L of 1 is equal to 3 plus 4j. You just see the list, what is printed in the right side, the 2 plus 3j is updated, the list itself updated. Okay, you can edit the list. So that is the reason this is called mutable. Okay, then there is some method called append. Okay, you can add an item to the end of the list. You can add an item to the end of the list. This is actually called append method. For example, L dot append, I want to add an item. Okay, by default it will be added at the end. Okay, I want to add some name Vamsi. Now I am printing Kayal. You can notice earlier the list was up to 200. Now an item Vamsi is added at the end. Okay, append method to add an item, okay, to the list. Suppose I don't want to add an item at the end, I want to add in the specific location. In such case, I can go for insert method. So since we are going to insert in the specific location, okay, you need two inputs. One is what is the location and other one is what is the value you are going to insert. For example, this is 0 location, this is 1. In the second position, before we note, I want to include another complex number 3 plus 4j. Okay, so L dot insert, I'm just giving the index 0, 1, 2. I want to add 3 plus 4j. That's it. You can notice 100 after 2 plus 3j, 3 plus 4j has come. Vinod 40.2, 1000, 2000. This Vamsi will not come because Vamsi, I just deleted that part. Okay, I just commented that part, so it won't work. It will consider only this list. Okay, in this list, it is inserting. Append method, insert method. Okay, append method, insert method. You need time to practice. Shall I continue?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, now, if you want to remove an item, okay, you can use remove method. You can use remove method to remove an item. For example, L dot remove. The remove method is removing by value. Okay, say I want to remove 2 plus 3j. Okay, this is the list. I want to remove 2 plus 3j. So what is the value you are going to remove? That value itself I am putting here. You just see after 100, the 2 plus 3j has been removed. Remove method.
Sir, I have a doubt, sir.
Yes.
Sir, without giving the number, can we give the position of the?
Yeah. I'll come to
that.
I'll come to that. See, the remove method. I said you will be removing by the value. Suppose you want to remove by index. Okay, if you want to remove by index, you have to use pop method. Okay, pop method. For example, L dot pop in bracket, say I want to remove this 2 plus 3j, the index is 1. Let me try this. Okay, you can notice the output, the 2 plus 3j by index, I have removed the 2 plus 3j. Vamsi, this one only you asked, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Suppose if I don't give any index, if I don't give any index, by default, it will remove the last item. It will remove the last item. You just see here there is 200, that 200 is not there here. Okay. Say I have two list, L1, L2, okay, I have another list, say it has 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, okay. if I want to add two list, then very simple thing, I can use plus operator. Okay, just do this L1 plus L2. You can see both the list are getting added. Very easily the list are getting added. See, this you can do, okay, instead of plus operator, you can do it with for loop also. I will give the idea. I'm just running the for loop for I in second list. Okay. What I'm doing in the first list, I'm just doing this append. Okay. After this, let me print the first list. I'll check whether this is working. Can you understand what is happening? I am defining two lists, L1 and L2. I am running the loop for the second list. So each and every item of the second list, okay, that will be appended. Appended in the sense, at the end of first list, one by one, the items from the second list are getting added. So if you are not comfortable, you just use line number 37. Very, very simple. L1 plus L2. Okay. Suppose if you want to copy a list, okay, if you want to copy a list, okay, I have L1, L2, suppose L3, L3 is equal to L1, okay. If you see L3, whatever the elements available in L1, the same thing is copied to L3. But there is a drawback. I will tell what is the drawback. Say what I'm doing, I'm just adding an item to L1. Okay, I'm just adding an item to L1. You just see this Babu, I'm just using append method. Append method means it will add the item at the end. So it has added the item at the end. Now if you see L3, okay, in L3 also the same changes are coming. So my expectation is up to certain point, whatever is there in L1, that should be copied to L3. But after that, after copying, if I do some updation in L1, that I don't want to be reflected in L3. If that is your requirement, then you can go for this method, okay, L3 equal to list of L1, okay, list of L1. Wait a minute, I will define L1 again, because L1 is, okay, this is L1. Taking original L1. What I am doing, L3 is equal to list constructor L1. So what happens, L1, I'm just copying, I'm just convert, already it's list, I'm using list constructor and I'm just copying that to L3. Now you see L1 and L3, they have the same value. Now I'm repeating the same procedure. I'm just adding Babu using append method to L1. So in the L1, that Babu is added, whereas L3, that is not added. Okay, L3, that is not added. So if you want to copy whatever the changes you want to make in one variable, that also if you want to be reflected in other variable, then you can use simple assignment. You want to copy up to certain stage. After that, whatever the changes you are making, that you don't want to affect the other variable, then you just use list method. Okay, then you just use list method. Is it okay? Is this clear, students?
Yes, sir.
I'll stop. Yes. You have doubts? You have any doubts? Anyone? Okay. See, I will go for tuples. Okay, I'll go for tuples. So what are the features of tuples? Again, it is a data structure. So sequence, basically it's a sequence. So tuple is ordered. That means you have an indexing, positive indexing, negative indexing. It is ordered, but it is immutable. This is very important. Once created, you cannot add, you cannot update. Once created, you cannot update. You cannot add, you cannot delete, you cannot do any updation. Okay. So it allows duplicate members. So you can ask me, already we have the list. Why do we want tuples? So people say that we are working with a very smaller size data just for understanding the fundamentals. But if you are working with larger data, okay, when you process the data, when you process the sequence in terms of tuples, the speed of processing gets increased. This is what they identified. That is one advantage. And another advantage is list is good for homogeneous data structure. Okay, that means if the list contains all the items of the list are from same data type, then it is good. Okay, I don't say that it won't work. Okay, it's not that much efficient. Whereas tuples can handle heterogeneous data types effectively. Okay, but when compared to list, tuples have limited functionalities. That is the drawback. Okay, so based on the requirement, you just decide whether you want to go for a list or tuples. In one word, if you want me to say, tuples are immutable list. That's it. Tuples are immutable list. How do you define a tuple? How do you define a tuple? Okay. Say X is the tuple. You have to use round brackets, then the items you separate by comma. Okay, items you separate by comma. You can notice whatever I have defined that is coming. You can check what is the data type of this X. It's tuple in nature. Okay, X is tuple. See, some people, what they do, they don't use the brackets also. Okay, they don't use brackets also. You just see, if I use that round bracket or if I don't use round bracket, by default, it is stored in the tuple format. You can check type of Y, it is tuple. Okay, So now let me ask you a question. See, I forgot to tell one thing in the list. Okay, if you want to create an empty list, just square bracket, just open, close. It's an empty list. Okay, it's an empty list. Another feature I forgot to say, if you have a list, you can use LEN to find out the length of the list. Okay, in MATLAB there is length command, LENGTH, similar to that LEN. Okay, that will help you to find out how many number of items present in the list. These are the two things I forgot to say. There are other built-in functions, something like min of L. What is the minimum value of L? Maximum value of L. Okay, sum of L. So these are some built-in functions. So these functions, len, min, max, sum, these functions will work for tuple also. Okay, these functions are common functions for tuple. If you want to define a empty tuple, just round bracket. Okay, if you see the type of x, it is tuple, empty tuple. Okay, empty tuple. Suppose now my question is, I want you people to define a tuple with only one item. Define a tuple with only one item. Can anyone help me how to do that? I want to define a tuple with only one item. Can you help me? See whether it is right or wrong, that's different. Okay. How can I define?
Sir, within the open bracket, sir.
In the bracket. Then you want to add some item. Am I right? That one item. Okay. So let me hit enter. Z. You just see the type of Z. It is not a tuple. It is an integer. If it is a tuple, here itself, you might have seen the value with brackets. So what I want to say, if you want to define a tuple, if you want to define a tuple with only one element, add a comma after that element. Okay, add a comma after that element. Now it is a tuple. Okay. Just one item within the bracket, that is not tuple. Okay, but if you have one item, then you just add a comma, that is a tuple. One item tuple. Okay, see now, if you understood how to access the list item, in the same fashion, we can access the tuple items. Okay, here also that positive indexing and negative indexing are possible. How this is working means this is ordered. Okay, so you can, since it is ordered, you can access the elements with indices. Okay, say for example, 0, it means the first item, it's 1. Okay. For example, if I want to access VAT 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's VAT. If you want to access the second letter, okay, second letter of VAT, then I have to use another square bracket, then you give 1, 1 indicates first index, 0th index, first index. You can notice it is printing I. Okay, it is printing I. You can go for negative indexing as usual. You have to start from right to left. So minus 1 indicates this 100.34. 100.34. Okay, minus 5 indicates Z. Again, you can have range of indices, for example 2 to 6. So 2 indicates 3, 4, 5. It won't, okay, wait a minute, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 will not be printed because the 6 is stop index. So it is printing 3, 4, A, Z. You can also include step size. Now it is 2 and 4 alone. So you will get 3 and A. 2 is 3. Okay. 2, 3, 4 is A. So it is printing A. See, suppose I said it is immutable in the sense once it is created, you cannot change. For example, X is the tuple. I want to change first item to 10. I don't want to. I'm doing that. You can notice the error. Tuple object does not support item assignment. Even you can try for that append method, insert method, pop, delete, everything. So all those methods will not work because this is immutable. Once it is created, you cannot change it. But if you want to really if you want to change, there is a option. So please follow this. What I'm doing, y is equal to list of x. Now y has become the list. Now I am doing y of 1 is equal to 20. Okay, y of 1 is equal to 20. Okay, I am again doing x is equal to tuple of y. Can you understand what is happening? See, now instead of 2, I have 20. So I know that tuple is immutable, whereas the list is mutable. So using list constructor, I am converting tuple x to y. So if you see y, it will be in list format. You just see there is a square bracket. Now I am just changing the first item of y from 2 to 20. Again, I am converting y to x, okay, I'm just converting y in tuple format that is stored in x, okay. So you cannot directly process the tuple, but you can convert the tuple into list and you can do whatever you want. Is it clear, participants? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
See, then that length method I already said, you can go for other functionalities of this tuple count. Okay, say for example, I'm just intentionally I'm adding two more ones. Okay. So this is actually count method. What it will do, it just counts how many number of times one, okay, how many number of times one occurs in the tuple. So I expected three, okay, three times one is coming, so it has given the correct answer. Even I can give some other character, okay, A, so it should display one. Yeah, it is displaying one. Okay, one time A has occurred. Suppose I'm giving L, which is not there here. You just see the count is zero. Okay, that particular item, you can understand that particular item is not present. Okay, count method. So that particular item, how many number of times that particular item is occurring, okay, in that particular tuple. Okay, this is given by the count method. Then there is something called index method. Okay, see, I want to know, see, manually you might have seen, I'm just counting what is the index of this 1, 2, 3, I'm just counting. Say, for example, what is the index of this z? So what I'm doing, x dot index, I'm just giving that item. So just print this. Okay, just print this. You can see it is fifth item. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Z is fifth item. Suppose if I give VAT, it's seventh item. So index method will give the index of a particular item. See, like, list, you can add two tuples. For example, I have another tuple. Okay, you can easily add these two tuples, print x plus y, that's it. You can notice only one tuple, both the tuples are combined. Okay, both the tuples are combined. Shall we go for the next one? Shall we go for the next one?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now we'll start the third one. Set. Okay. Again, it is a data structure, sequence. Okay, very important thing is, when in contradiction to list and tuple, this is unordered. Okay, set items are unordered. Another one is unindexed. So there is no indexing, unindexed. Okay. Another important feature, non-duplicate. It is mutable. So unordered in the sense, okay, so earlier zeroth item, zero means the corresponding item, positive indexing, negative indexing, accessing the items through indices, deleting the items through indices, all those things are possible. Now set, okay, it is unordered. Since it is unordered, you cannot access the set items through index. That's very important. And duplicate items are not possible. If you notice in set and tuple, one I used several times, 100 I used several times. Okay, duplicate items are possible, whereas here duplicate items are not possible. In set, duplicate items are not possible. But it is mutable. Mutable in the sense, once created, you can change it. Okay, once created, you can change it. So I just want to define a set. Yes, just to define a set, you need to use braces. Okay, open brace and close brace. Let me define some items. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Print S. You can notice it is printing. Let me see what is the type. Okay, what is the type? It is set. S is basically set. Okay, S is basically set. See what I'm doing? I'm just repeating the item. You just notice I have 5, 4. Okay, I'm just repeating the item. Okay, maybe one more item, 8, 9. I'm just repeating the item. If I execute, you just notice, even though there are 2 5s, only 1 5 has come. Even though there are 2 4s, only 1 4 has come. So it is non-duplicate. Okay, it is non-duplicate. So one item will present only one type. Okay, one item will present only one type. Not necessarily the numbers, you can have even characters, string, something like this, it will work. Okay, let me remove the duplicates. Even if you include, it won't consider those things. Okay, now since it is mutable, again people developed the functions to add, methods to add items to the set. Okay, so there is add method to add items to the set. For example, I'm just adding Unni. You just see Unni is getting added. Can anyone notice I have given the input in this order, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 8. Then I have given Vinod. Then I have given 10.2. But here you just notice 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 8. Then 10.2 has come. Then Vinod has come. Then the new item. So what is happening? I already said it is unordered. Okay. It's actually, if you execute again and again, you can notice. Okay. It will be printed in different order. Okay, it will be printed in different order. Okay, so it is mutable. After creating also, you can append the items. Okay, say another time, I'm just adding another name. You just see, I added Vishnu at the end, but it has come in the middle itself, before this Vinod and Unni and other things, okay, this 8 and 10.2, it has come in between. So set is basically unordered, okay, but after creating you can update. That's what I want to convey. Suppose you want to add more items. For example, there are other students, Deepika, I can see some names. Say for example, D is equal to Deepika. So my system got stuck, just a minute. Better I will restart. So just give you a minute. I'm just restarting my spider. See what I will do before it's opening. I will just show some set operations. You can practice those set operations in your system. It's opened. Okay, see, until my system is ready, I'll just display some of the set operations. You can practice these things. Can you see my slide?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, there are two sets, A and B. You know what is A union B? A union B. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No duplicates are allowed. So 4, 5 will come only one time. So then 6, 7, 8. So if you want to do this in Python, first define A and B. Then you can use the pipe symbol. A, okay, pipe B. A, pipe B. You can notice you are getting this output. Are you getting that output? See, I'll just finish that update one. Okay. Say I have some items. Okay. 200, 300. Okay. I want to add this list to the set. Then what I can do? S dot update. Okay. I can give this D. Print S. So what it actually does means, okay, this update method, if you want to add one item at a time, you can use add method. But if you want to add more than one items at a time, then you can use this update method. You can notice this is unordered. As I said, this is unordered. Actually, these two are mixed, but this is a part of the set. All these items, the new items, that is part of the set. That is what I want to convey. Update method. Then if you want to remove an item, already we know that set is unindexed. So if you want to remove, you need to remove by the value. Say for example, I want to remove 40 from the set. You just see 40 has been removed. So what I want to convey, this is unordered, unindexed, non-duplicate, but if you want to add elements, if you want to delete elements, you can do it. So this is mutable. Okay. We'll just discuss some of the set operations. I'm just directly presenting here. A is equal to one set, B is another set, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. If you want to do union operation, A pipe B. Okay, A pipe B, execute. You can notice it is giving the result 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, A union B. Suppose if you want to do AND operation, intersection operation, you have to use ampersand. Okay, so if you see between these two set, 4 and 5, they are the common elements. You can see 4 and 5, okay, is getting displayed here. Is it clear, students?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Then the third operation, A minus B, this minus actually indicates set difference. Set difference in the sense, whatever the items present in A, but that should not present in B. The items present in A, but that should not present in B. So if you see 4, 5 is present in B, so except that 1, 2, 3 is available, so this should present 1, 2, 3. If I do the reverse, whatever the items present in B, but that should not present in A, so those items are 6, 7, 8. Okay, it is unordered, so it is giving in some random order. This is actually called a set difference. There is something called a symmetric difference. For symmetric difference, you use at or cap symbol. What is symmetric difference? You might have studied this in mathematics. symmetric difference in the sense between these two set A and B, what is the intersection? That is 4, 5. So exclude that 4, 5, whatever the remaining items are there, that you just do union. So excluding 4 and 5, I have 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 8. That is actually symmetric difference. You can notice 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 8. Okay. So in digital communication, in all those places, you use set concept. Actually, modulation, if you go for a particular modulation, say for example, BPSK, they say only two symbols, plus one and minus one. So that is actually represented as set, because there are no duplicates, either plus one or minus one. Similarly, QPSK, that four symbols, 1/√2 plus J 1/√2, they are the only possibilities. So that is actually that that modulation order, or the number of that symbols, bits to symbol mapping, actually represented by set idea. Okay, we'll go for the last one in the data structure. It is dictionary concept. So first, let me define a dictionary data structure. So just to store a sequence, then it is unordered, mutable, see, since it is unordered, you cannot access it through index. Okay, so dictionaries will have a key value pair, actually. Okay, dictionaries will have a key value pair. I'll explain what is key and what is value. See, these keys are unique. Duplicates are not allowed, but values can repeat. How do you define a dictionary? Again, I'm going to use curly braces to define a dictionary. Okay, again, I'm going to use curly braces to define a dictionary. So within the dictionary, if you have item something like that, you can understand, sorry, within curly braces, if you have items like this, you understand that it is a set. But if you have items something like this, you understand it is not a dictionary, it is not a set, it is a dictionary. So each one is a key and the corresponding value. Okay, so keys and values, they are separated by colon. Each key value pair, okay, that is separated by comma. This is very important. So it's mutable. Okay, after creating also, you can change it, you can change the dictionary. Okay, but it is unordered, so you cannot access it through indices. So you have a key value pair. With the key values, you can access the items. Okay, so in order to define a dictionary, again, you are going to use curly braces. So each item is represented by a key value pair. Keys and values are separated by colon. Then each key value pair, that is separated by comma. Okay, see, you can define, I'll come to the point later. Up to this, is it clear, students?
Yes, sir.
Uh, So let me define a dictionary. Okay. The dictionary name is, okay, this is the dictionary name, braces, first key in ADSP, okay, she scored 98, advanced digital communication 94, some mathematics course, okay, 88. Some antenna course, 81, something like this. Now, if you print the dictionary name, you can notice, okay, it is printing some value. If you see the type, it is basically a dictionary. Okay, it is basically a dictionary. I said if it is empty list, empty square bracket, empty tuple, round bracket, empty round bracket. If you just use empty square, this curly braces, you may expect the answer that it is a empty set, but surprisingly, it is not empty set, it is a empty dictionary. If you want to define a empty set, then you just use this set constructor. This is empty set. So if you just use curly braces, that is, okay, empty dictionary. Okay, empty dictionary. See these keys, you just see this particular key. These are keys and the values. I used a string, but it's not necessarily string. You can go for integer also, okay, not only integer, even float. You just see now also it's working. I can go for float key also, it's working. I can go for a complex number. It is not necessarily string, okay, just for my convenience I'm just using this one. So since it is unordered, how do you access the list item, dictionary items? So it's very easy. Dictionary name in bracket, the key. Dictionary name in bracket key, execute. You can see for ADC, the corresponding value is 94. Okay, you can access that 94. Okay, so another thing, antenna engineering, ANT, it's 81. Okay, I want to justify this mutable. What is, how this is mutable? See, I want to add another item to the dictionary. Maybe, I don't know, I don't remember the subject, any subject, okay, wireless communication or modern wireless communication, okay, she scored 78. So this is the key, dictionary name in bracket key and the corresponding value. Now execute the code, you can notice this MWC and the corresponding value that has become a member of this dictionary. So you can update the dictionary. Okay, you can update the dictionary. This has become a member, MWC has become a member. Okay, suppose already this ADSP is there. You just see what is happening. The recent ADSP that has overwritten the previous one. Okay, that has overwritten the previous one. You see ADSP is there, but it does not have the same value. It is having the recent value. Okay, I said keys are unique whereas values can be same. For example, I can have same value in both. See, it's not showing any error. And these keys are case sensitive. Suppose if I use something like this, this will become an item to the list. This small, this ADSP, this will become an item of this dictionary. So values can repeat, keys are unique. So if you are using the same key, the recent value will be updated. See, alternatively, if you want to get an item, okay, from the list, dictionary, you can also use get method. So get in bracket, you can give the key. If you want to remove an item, see, again, no other option. Since it is unordered, you cannot use index. So you have to use the keys only. Just execute. Okay, now see what is happening. It is telling what is the value removed. If you type the dictionary, you can see the change. You can see that ADSB has been removed. ADC, Max, and Antenna, that's only available. This particular key value pair that has been removed from the dictionary. So how to add, how to delete. So since you can add, you can update, you can delete, this is mutable. The list is mutable. So again, you can use actually length to find out length of the dictionary. It's 3. So totally 3 items are present. So the length is 3. See, if you want, okay, if you want only the keys, okay, if you want only the keys, dictionary name dot keys, you just execute. You can see these are the keys. Okay, these are the keys used in the dictionary. If you want only the values, you can see these are the values. These are the values from the dictionary. Okay, these are the values from the dictionary. Keys, values. Suppose if you want both, then you can use items in tuple format, it will give the result. See, this is the key corresponding value, one tuple. This is the key corresponding value, tuple, key value, tuple. See, now the question is, can I use for loop? Can I use for loop to access the items of the dictionary one by one? Can I use the for loop to access the items of dictionary one by one? Yes, for I in the dictionary name, print, how to access the dictionary. Okay, if I give, sorry, I need to give I. If I just give this, it will display the keys one by one. You just see, so first ADSP is the key, then ADC is the key, then MAT, then ANT. These are the keys. It just displays the key one by one. If you want values, what you can do? Bracket, you give the key. See, you can get the values. If you want key value pair, you give like this. So today morning we discussed about loop, for loop. You can use for loop for dictionaries also. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. Sir.
What I will do, I'll just take functions just for 10 minutes and then I will wind up. Actually, the entire last session is for the functions. I'll just give one or two examples in functions and we can wind up. So I'm not giving a break now. Okay, we'll just go for functions. Say A is equal to 10.2. Round of A. So what it is doing, this is a function. This is actually a built-in function. This is actually a built-in function. So it takes the input A and it is rounding and it is giving the result. For many of the times, we need to create our own functions. We won't be doing that operation throughout, but whenever required, we have to do that. Okay, so in such cases, we'll go for the functions. You will have a main program. From the main program, you will pass the inputs, input arguments. The function will do some operation, it will return some output. Okay, so what I'm going to talk here is user defined function, how to create user defined functions in Python. Create user defined functions in Python. In order to define a user defined function, you need to use the keyword define. So if you use DEF, Python understands that the user is going to define a function, followed by the function name. I'm just giving a function, allow function. Okay. Then round bracket. See, in the round bracket, we have to give what is the input argument we are going to pass. Okay. You can pass any number of input arguments. Okay. You cannot pass also. Okay. No need to pass also. If the function really requires, then you have to pass. Very simple thing. You just notice there is a colon, then there is an indentation. Want to print hello Python whenever this function is called. That's it, very simple function, no input argument. Let me call this function. This is the user defined function. See, whenever I call, it will print this. I am defining another function with one input. For example, define f is the function. I'm getting one input a. The function has to return a square. So if I give 2, it has to give 4. If I give 10, it has to give 100. Okay, see, this return keyword is important because this is actually the function calculates something and it is returning to the main program. Now you see f of 5, it is giving 25, f of 10, it is returning 100, f of 3, it is returning 9. So one input, the function receives one input and it is returning. Like that, you can define the user defined functions. Let me define another function, square. Say is taking one input argument side. This function calculates, okay, perimeter and the area. So perimeter is 4 times side. The area is side square. Am I right? 4a a square. Okay. So now I have to return both perimeter and area. Square. I'm giving some number 10. You just see there are two outputs. First perimeter, then it is returning the side. So these are user defined functions. Okay, according to your requirement, you can define the user defined function. From the main program, you can supply the inputs and you can call. Okay, see, actually the console, I am supplying the inputs. It goes here, it calculates and it is returning. This is how it is working. So another one, if you type round is built-in function. Then if you add a question mark, you can see the documentation for the round. This is the syntax. Signature is nothing but syntax. What is the use of round? A number to a given precision. So if you don't give the second input, what will happen? It says that it is a built-in function, all those things. Now the question is, shall we include documentation for the user-defined function? Shall we include documentation for the user-defined function? Yes, it is possible. So what you can do, after defining the function, you just add triple quotes. You can notice a pop-up something like generate docstring. Just click that. See, automatically a template is coming. You can notice a template. So parameters, what is side? Okay, I'm just typing. It is side of a square. Okay, I'm sorry. This should be the description. Earlier it was type. Say it should be an integer. Description, side of a square. Then P, say for example, I'm just giving float. The description, perimeter of a square. Similarly, area, for example, float, okay, area of a square. I just added the documentation, execute. Now for your own function, if you add the question mark, you can see whatever the documentation I have added, that is displayed here. Side int, side of the square, P should be in float. It is actually perimeter of a square. So whatever you want, you can write it here. So if you want to do a good programming, if you want to generate your own user defined function, then obviously you need to add the documentation, because after a certain point you will forget whether this square will do a squaring operation or it indicates a square, rectangle, like that. Okay, so the generating docstring is very important for user defined function. Okay, the functionalities, the Python, there are many built-in functions, but for your own applications, there are you are in a situation to develop the user defined functions, then you can use this defined function. Okay, see, that is, I just completed what I want to convey, but I didn't go for practice examples and all. I want to stop here. Can you switch on your videos? I just take a screenshot. Whoever attended, can you switch on your video for a minute? Okay. Okay, let me take yes. Thank you, students. Okay, thank you, students. I'm just posting a feedback link in the chat box. Please give your, please give your feedback. Just a minute. Can you check whether that feedback form is working? Okay, you can switch off your video. Thank you. Just check whether the feedback form is working. Just give your feedback. Unni, whether that feedback form is opening?
Yes, sir, it's opening, sir.
Okay, okay, good. Thank you. Okay, students, thank you for the opportunity. I'll just stop the session. You can complete the feedback form. Okay, if I get an opportunity again, we'll meet in some other workshop. Okay, thank you, students.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.